Hello viewers, and welcome to Social Impact and News Commentary Nagaland, a new weekly TV program coming to you from Nagaland Cornerstone Television. Today we are excited to start our first recording, and we'll have fresh new episodes every week. We have here today with us a panel of four members from various fields of life, namely a pastor, other laymen, writers, journalists, and a medical doctor. First of all, I want to request you all to introduce yourselves. I am Wobong Mo, director of Highland Dawn Media.
I'm Okenzit, editor, North Express Service.
My name is Dr. Vigatulie. I am from State Mental Health Institute.
I'm Kevin Meru, presently teaching in Asian Evangelical Bible Seminary.
Thank you all. The key vision, idea, and goal of this show is to have timely, mature, neutral, truthful, non-partisan, non-polarizing, and meaningful commentary on the current news and social issues of Nagaland. We want to touch upon general issues as a whole and less on politics.
We will also aspire to deal with issues from a position of civility in a fair manner, appreciating and giving chance for other viewpoint to the base of our ability. For any issue, we will present the truth, highlight the negatives, the positives, and finally dwell on suggestions and solutions. We do not claim to have answers to any of the issues to be discussed, but through discussion, we do want to bring it out to the public domain, thought and consciousness of individuals in our society.
And since the people of Nagaland are majority Christian, we also will hear out the Christian worldview or perspective on the issues our society and individuals are facing. Here, Reverend Kevin Meru, assisted by the panel, will be the main proponents or spokesman on the Christian perspective. And finally, since we, the panelists, are all agreed on the key vision and goals of the show, we will sometimes agree to disagree.
Yes.
And so every week, we will firstly check out our selected news headlines from the past week, and together we'll discuss its impact for us and our society.
Secondly, we will be having a relevant social issue affecting all of us to discuss.
Firstly, for our news commentary, let's have a news important news item to discuss. And do we have anything here?
Yeah, I have one news item here that is just today's newspaper. That is in the Eastern Mirror. It's a very interesting, our state education minister, Mr. Itasu, has been just giving one of the serious warning that the state education department entering into miserable failure. So here, even the commissioner school education was telling that there is an excess, you know, the defective data of so many things in education department.
Mm. Why is the minister himself saying that it's a miserable failure?
He has been the very truthful. In fact, even in the state assembly, recently concluded state assembly, he himself admitted that there is a failure in the education department. There is an excess employees in the department. The teachers were not, serving in the remote areas where they were posted. So many things are there. Then ghost teachers, absentees. And so many things like that. This is a very interesting, news we have come across today. Mm-hmm. And I think this is something like relevant to today's discussion.
Exactly. Yes. Education is very important, one of the most important departments for our society, for Nagaland. And we are aware that a lot of employees are employed in the education department. But it's very news-breaking that a minister himself would say that his own department is in a miserable condition. And we really appreciate it, perhaps as public. And perhaps more ministers could come out and say also things about their department. Any comments on this, on education?
Well, I'm not going to point any individual in particular, but I have heard a lot of stories about teachers. They just get their salary and they don't go to their postings if it's outside Nagale, Akwahima, or Dimapur, or their comfort zone. I think that's reflect poorly on their faith, whether they go to church or not. Maybe some of them do. And just to think that Nagaland was just a thick forest, headhunting back then, and missionaries came all the way and they gave up all their creature comforts and even risked their own lives and gave us the gospel. And here we have teachers who are paid by the state and not willing to do their job in helping their fellow Nagas. That's what they're supposed to do. That is a wonderful mission. It's a very honorable profession to be a teacher, you know. So it's very sad that some people can have that kind of thinking. And I'm going to tell you, these people, as a Christian, I must tell them, you need to repent. Because I don't care whether you fast 40 days or you give tithes, God is going to hold you accountable until you repent. When you repent, you say, I'm sorry, God, and you start doing your job, or you resign. That's it. If you are paid, you must do your job. That God holds you responsible on that one. We have not been taught that way in church. You know, that is the righteousness of God. So I have to tell the truth. So I'm not pointing fingers to any individual like that, but this is a teaching from the Bible and just sharing it because this is happening in Nagaland. Mm.
Definitely, that's very relevant. Integrity in terms of personal life, in terms of professional life, whatever profession we are in, perhaps, I mean, integrity is the need of the day. And you are touching upon, Pastor, talking about, you know, the importance of teaching. In other countries, it's very important, right? Teaching is held in as a high respect. So why is it that it is so much in low esteem here?
Well, I think we are not that, we don't have in dedicated teachers. We're just after the money. That's
many of it, people.
And many parents, the rich ones, they're just sending all their children to all the best schools. We don't blame them. That I'm not blaming them. But the poor, they're left behind. There's no math teacher, no science teacher. How can they even pass matriculation? As a teacher, one of the subjects in my seminar I teach is remedial English. I have a lot of freedom in that. And I assess the students there. Some of them are terrible, according to the grade that they have gone through. I see so much defects in it. And the teachers, that themselves are saying we need more teacher training and all. But I think they must be taught with dedication as a mission. Or, like I said, they need to resign. They say, I cannot do it. I don't want to be responsible before God. So I don't want to be taking salary and just not doing my job. I think we have to come to that point.
Yes, I think, you know, like initially, teachers were also very esteemed because many of us have had very good teachers. You know, those of us beyond a certain age group, you know, we have had very senior good teachers. And we hope that there will be very good teachers even for the present generation. And we also really appreciate once again the American missionaries who had brought education and gospel all the way from America. Mm. And we are what we are today also partly because of them. Any one of you have more comments on this topic?
Yeah, I think our present governor, this PVSR, he was very much concerned about the educational systems in the state. In fact, in one of the discussions, he was telling that 70% of the government teachers are not in service. I mean, not serving. They are not attending to their duties. That is what he openly said, and he always tried to say that this has to be checked. Then another thing is, you see, in the remote areas, our teaching materials, like books, textbooks, and then even the students. They normally in the remote areas they used to appear their final exams without even seeing their textbooks even once in the academic year. It is one of the saddest part I have been telling, I have been writing on several occasions, and this is a serious condition. On this condition, you cannot expect that our children can be really, really something which we are expecting in the future. We cannot.
The state of education in Nagaland also, besides all the points that we have discussed, it also reveals one serious lapse in our society, that is lack of work ethics, which is seriously been missed. And I chiefly blame the church and the Christian leaders who have really failed to impart on this good aspect of Christianity, work ethics.
Yeah.
It should be interwoven into our culture so that work becomes a part of our lives. This is something which we have not learned. We have become very lazy as a matter of fact. And I feel we need to stress more on work ethics. Work and eat should be our slogan today.
Yes.
In fact, I want to add one thing. See, recently concluded assembly, there also, you see, they had discussed very seriously about these education issues. although we don't have an opposition, they call it that is oppositionless government. Actually, we don't have any question hour in the assembly. But this time, after the new chief minister took over, there was some question hour. At least five questions they have raised. Now you see, in one particular school, there was one student, one girl, that was, you know, disclosed on the floor of the assembly by one of the honorable members. Now you see this girl, when the bell was, you know, hit, the girl was at home and she was telling that this bell is for me. You know, that kind of thing was already there. So I think it's a very serious issue, and the issue is already discussed like this. There was a schools where a single student was there. I think it is something we have to thought of very seriously, and the education minister should be appreciated because he was admitting everything. He was not hiding. He was not trying to cover up.
At least here he's been very honest.
Yes. That's a start.
That's right.
Yes. Yeah. That's a start.
He's been very honest.
That's a start. Okay. Yes.
So actually we have dwelt a lot on one particular news item, and then I feel we need to move on to our social issue for the day. Our social issue topic for the day is the growing gap and inequal growth in society. We are all aware, many of us are aware of what is happening in our land. There is a growing gap between the haves and the have-nots, those with jobs and those without jobs, between the rich and the poor, and you know, whatever you call it, the gap is really increasing. And we want to discuss a little bit about this. Perhaps, Oken, you can say something?
I think in the job sector, if we studied in the last 10 years, and now we have the present job ratio is we have 1,40,000
employed.
Yeah, that is the highest job comparing with the neighboring states.
It has reached a saturation point.
Yes, saturation point. Now in Manipur, I'm told that they have only 60,000 government employees, and they have more population than us actually. In fact, in Nagaland, we have 19 something, little more than 19 lakhs population. But in reality, we have actually 13 lakh population. The rest is non-Nagas, like doubtful identities and all this we have discussed off and on, including the minister's concern. So many we discuss. So now if you look the ratio of the job and the population, is one is to, I don't know how much is coming. It is very frightening. Then other side is, again, if you look at about the trends in Nagaland, is that we don't have any, you know,
industries,
then the factories, and completely the state is dependent. We don't have any income generating kind of units. But again, the haves and have-nots, when we look at that, is if you look the people who are in the government service sectors and other things, this is basically now the present trend is, I think it is, I will not be surprised to say that it's all hijacked by those people who are in power, in authority. And it is something like, I have been always telling the next 5 to 10 years, I don't see that our present educated youth will get any job. I don't see that. It is a very dangerous trend we're going to have it.
Okay, before we pass on the discussion, I more quotes from social media, you know, this was our source. There is a gap between the rich and the poor. The political setup is dominated by the rich and bureaucrats. The power and powerless is measured by economic and political influence, unquote. So again, since we are talking about the gap in society, from a Christian perspective, Reverend KV, can you please share?
Oh, I think some gap will always be there, because unlike communism, we cannot make up for those lazy people. Some people, they're not diligent, they don't want to study, they don't want to hang around and, you know, leech on their parents' income and all that. That fact is there. But at the same time, our state being small, even when we produce good students, some of them have to go outside and look for a job, and which is what is happening with some diligent students. So that fact is there. But the quality of education or lack of it is going to increase the inequality. That's a big part of it. That's why we started there. I'm glad we discussed it, because that is a part of it. And so all the while, the people at the top, I think they're playing with the futures of Nagaland and our as a whole, the people or the younger generation, because they're not setting up things in a good way or in a very disciplined and structured manner for them to thrive. That is not there. We have lack of accountability, let's put it that way. That is a big part of it. Otherwise, if some very blatant things are happening, we should be able to file lawsuit against them and win damages and even discipline them and even push them out of office. That is not there.
But even in terms of merit, terms of merit, if we look it's at the merit, why is it, there is nothing like that. There is no merit. Yeah. It's simply, we know that even I am the best in my schools, supposing, then I know for sure that I will not get job because I don't have money. Corruption is at its own, you know, we have reached the highest peak. And in other states, I started telling that Nagaland is the most corrupted state. It's a very sad, it was not heard of in the past.
So, I mean, people say that the difference is also because of the lack of sharing of opportunity, and the other classes, they do not get their fair share, whereas it's been shared by the top level or by the, you know, creamy layer, so-called. Also, a lot of corruption and nepotism going on, favoritism, tribalism, you know. So why all these things combined together to bring about this growing gap? You know, we are here to discuss about it.
You see, I think, Reverend, we have discussed. You see, now, for example, like our educated youths, we have seen enough that how they have been debating in the social media. And they are also for sure that they will not get job, these people. Mm. Now, the only thing is that I have been telling, I do not know whether it is fair enough to be discussed, but I have been telling that we have to change our leadership. Mm. And young people should involve in politics. Mm. Because it is the power. If once a good people are in the power, they can do it.
Yes.
They can do it. Because all this is nepotism, whatever, favoritism, all these things. Supposing in one particular department, it's not that we don't want to refer anyone personally, but we have seen that how the excess employment has been met, you know, in one particular department. Mm. And it keep increasing. On the other side, they said that the employment ban is there.
But can they not reverse?
Yes.
Those can be reversed or not? Based on that it's been improperly or illegally, unlawfully done?
I think NGOs or some kind of concerned group is started coming up and properly, you know, investigate and started doing, we never know that, because many of the employments, I mean, that may be illegal, not properly employed, because never this is done from the NPSC. Something like that.
Okay, before you guys move on, let me also add one more point while it's hot on my mind. And this is again from biblical point of view. I have heard, and it is true, that some people they're holding two jobs, three jobs, government jobs, three streams of salaries, and they're sending proxies and all that, but getting a huge chunk of it themselves through political favor and all that. I think from the Christian perspective, if you are a Christian, you must give it up. You must say you are sorry and give it up, hold to one job. Give the rest, the extra ones that you're holding, you must give it up. Otherwise, let me invoke heaven. You're not going to heaven. Let me be clear. We think if we get more money, they don't care. But I'm telling you, God cares. And these are the things. We say grace, grace. No, grace does not condone unrighteousness. Mm. So that one, I'm telling you, if anybody is here or your relatives, you know anybody, warn them that they're not entering the kingdom of heaven if they're holding things like that and thinking they can go to heaven by giving to church or activities like that. No, it's not there. So that's a point,
yes,
I would like to say. Because Nagaland being majority Christian, so
you're saying, talking about grace. Grace goes along with truth. Without truth, there is no grace. Mm. Without integrity.
One title of Jesus Christ is Melchizedek. We call it Melchizedek, King of Righteousness. Mm. So he's King of Righteousness and he hates unrighteousness. That's what the scripture says. Mm. And he's the one who gives grace.
Anything from your side, Doctor?
Yeah, this is the way I see about our inequality. In the first place, we cannot have a very equal society. We live in an open economy. So in an open economy, there's bound to some disparity between the rich and the poor, between the haves and the have-nots. But so the harder you work, the more you're going to earn, and so you get rich. So that justifies inequality.
That's true.
But in our Nagaland context, we see that definitely there's a growing disparity between the rich and the poor. And it is quite related to the person, those of them who have access to the power corridors. They have more access to its resources. And they are the ones who are getting richer, getting fatter. But those of them, unfortunate ones, who have no access to the powers, they are the ones who are not coming up the social ladder. So it appears that we do have a certain amount of inequality growing in the society.
And recently, even the one of the ministers on the past government, the minister, former minister of power, he has admitted that there is a yawning gap between the rich and the poor in Naga society. He said, however, that no citizen is denied the basic needs, you know. Anyway, so in their interaction with students of St. Joseph, he was also saying that hard work and dignity of labor has not been properly indoctrinated in Naga society, as well as he indicated that inculcating simple living and high thinking, he supported that, and parents have to play a role in forming children of vision. That was a government minister very recently. So we are really in the midst of this yawning gap, which is growing. So how could we also, you know, we are aware of it, we are aware of the situation of the issue, but how could we reduce the gap perhaps?
Yeah, to my mind, to reduce the gap, there has to be a constant change of government. If a ruling party rules for too long, it deprives the opposition party and its supporters of its resources. So the gap between the rich and the poor increases, partly because of that. Partly, another reason, another way where we can bridge the gap is by encouraging more educational development and refinement. As our friends have said, quality education will determine economic development. And focus on the two, education along with economic development. And to my mind, thirdly, we need to invite industries and other sectors to come and invest in Nagaland, where they can create and generate job opportunities. This way we can have a more equal society.
And people also say that, you know, if there's a success story, or if an elder person or somebody is very successful in his field of life, he or she could also show it how it has been done to other people in his community. As we all know, in Naga, in our history, in the Naga village, there was community, democratic equality, and all this, you know, social equality going on. And it seems there was a concern also for the less privileged and poor of the village. For example, the rich would also organize a community feast whereby the poor people could also come and enjoy the feast. And also, the poor people were also taken care of, from what our elders say, you know, they were given some from the harvest. So that had been going on. But now we are in a totally reverse situation where the rich has perhaps no concern for the poor, or less concern. So we also know that there were less thieves in Naga, in our villages earlier. And what other points come to your mind, please, this year?
We have no industries, that's for sure. So the economy is just, we're depending on the government handout. Or monsoon of finances flowing to our state. But to invite industries, we need to, this has to be very specific. We need to know, the society need to be aware that those industries must be protected from tax collectors. Their demand is ridiculous. They demand so much money. I think we should even say to the national people, yes, you're trying to solve Naga issues, but these areas, you should start to think and then give them a break. But if we give them that protection, I think some little industries might even start. I don't know which particular one, but that one, on taxation on that one, where even the oil refinery that they're supposed to do in Nagaland, but they send it to Assam because how many several thousands of crores they demanded. That's from our national workers. So I'm telling you the truth. Give it up. Don't be too greedy.
That just because it's a big industry does not mean you should tax this much demand like that. I think with that, Naga has to be aware of that. Otherwise, one day, if these things doesn't work out well, the Naga youth might turn against them, because the awareness is coming up. They're affecting even our road, but we're not going into particulars now. So I'm not blaming anybody, but this is what is reality, saying that.
Yeah, indeed, awareness is really increasing among our people, the younger people also. And we also need to increase awareness among the elderly people, our age group and younger. And we are all agreed, perhaps, that growing equality is also because of the lack of equal education and lack of equal economic development.
Yes.
So any other reasons for this growing gap, or how could we also...
I just want to... I think Oliverian has touched one of the most important things he has touched. That is, we agreed to that. Now you see the kind of culture we had to teach. We really don't want to work hard. What I had seen, we don't want to compete. We don't just want to earn. We just want to get everything at free. You know, we don't want to give our labor. Now you see, even in a minister's quarter, everybody will come and ask money. That is what I have in experience. They will just come and ask money. Nobody is coming to ask for job. That is what I have been warning to the ministers. This is going to create a social chaos in the future, because we are not educating our youth. We have set such a way, and we have made such an impression that they can live so long. I am minister. Finish. I will provide your family. I will just try to provide money, food, everything, even the children of some family in the villages, inter-village families. Their children should be taken care of, educational, careers, this and what. Because they have never thought. I think this is a very dangerous trend, what I have seen.
This and is one of the roots of all the social evils.
Yes, social evils. This is coming.
To get something free.
That's yes, right. Everything is free.
I've helped him come to power, or yes. I've voted for him, so I have a right to demand from him. Mm. So that is the root of all these social evils, one of the root.
In fact, even we have been telling to the ministers or politicians that please don't do this. Please stop giving money to them. Instead, you discuss with them how to go forward, how to live as a responsible citizen, how to earn, how to be, you know, a responsible father in the family, something like that.
Besides the points that we have discussed, all good, relevant points, I also want to add a few more points, socially related. One is laziness. We have become a very lazy society. You don't see much poverty in a very hardworking society. It's always on the upward trend, moving forward, progressing economically. Then we have become a very lazy society. Then another problem that I see is some of the social vices, like addiction to alcohol, which is badly affecting the family's budget and the entire economy, and also affecting the social stability, family integrity also. So addiction, drug addiction and alcohol addiction is another cause for this growing inequality. Then I also blame chiefly on the system of our present educational system. This needs a lot needs to be done on this educational system, which is not quite the way it should go. We need to improvise. We need to innovate. We need to bring about some radical change.
For inculcating the work ethic.
Yes, uh-huh. In the work at inculcate work ethics in our education system. Inculcate work ethics in the family system. Talk more about work ethics in the pulpit. You know, some changes has to come on these three key institutions.
Even very interesting thing is, you see, like supposing, if I want to construct a house, definitely I'm not going to employ my own people to construct it. These doubtful identities, the people coming who did not have any basic, you know, qualification as a constructor, you know. I mean, for that, the thing is, we will all employ, even Dudwala. We use them by our contractors, even in the heart of the capital for road repairing, these people, instead of using these workers as employees. Then we have the engineerings. But these people are constructing house. Whereas our engineers are just watching. I think we have to think very seriously on these issues. And we do not have confidence in our own people. Supposing if I want to catch a taxi, I will just look the driver. If the driver is not non-local, then I'm preferred to traveling with this vehicle. How to bring back to this, you know, trust and confidence amongst ourselves first? This is a very, very important, because I don't trust my own people. I don't want to employ my own people to do something in my own, you know, construction works. Mm-hmm. This is destroying our system. And now supposing I have children, they're all educated, they're graduates. And I know that, how do I employ them? Because I'm not very sure that they will get job because I don't have money. And I don't want to use unfair means in influencing my relationship with some other people to get job, because we are fighting for this kind of unfair means. So this kind of trend is happening in each and every family now. And I think our society, our social issues in the societies, the trust and that kind of thing which is trust deficit which we are having amongst ourselves has to be resolved first. That is very important.
Okay, so back to our topic. I mean, are you saying that the lack of trust is also leading to the gap between,
yes,
you know, this and
very
that?
Very much.
And yeah, Reverend.
Yes.
Yeah, well, okay, yes. Your point taken. One positive side is that there's a few youth here and there, or some people that are doing really entrepreneurial work, and they're working hard.
Yes.
But overall, they're just the exceptions. And concerning that one, we are Nagas, where we are spoiled with yelling out orders to others.
Yes. Yes.
That's the one. Even in Calcutta, some Nagas, they went there, and then they start yelling to the people, just like they did in Nagaland, but that's a different way, different situation, but they didn't realize it. So an outsider come, one guy came from Sikkim and said, "You Nagas talk very rough. We're very gentle." Mm-hmm. That's a very gentle culture. Mm-hmm. So we talk very rough. Even South Indians, I heard, they come here and then after a few years, they start to talk very rough. They go back, they realize they're very rough.
Yes, yes.
So that's one thing is, mm-hmm, when we choose non-locals, you know, mm-hmm, we can talk, give them order and talk like that.
Okay.
With locals, we're afraid.
Yes, right. Okay. Coming back to our the growing gap between the haves and the haves not, very important for a society, very, very important. And so what are your suggestions, you know, whereby we can reduce this gap? Quality education is one, equal opportunity is one, but how, you know, and also, yeah, the growing gap, how to reduce
government
the gap?
Government accountability. Mm-hmm. Government plays a big role in this, politics and bureaucrats.
I think we also need to sensitize amongst our you know, youngsters, and we need to have we have a lot of social media platforms today. Then I think we should try to promote and disseminate the importance of what, because everything is in our fingertips.
Plus change of government at regular intervals.
Yes.
Plus change of mindset, right?
Yes, yes.
Before we end, any concrete final words from any one of you? Yes.
From a Christian perspective, yes. Know your job, what area you are appointed for, and fulfill it faithfully. I think that's what it should be,
think, yeah,
in the first place.
I think
as believers, even non-Christians can do that. Why not we do it more? Whatever you do, do it for the glory of God, as Scripture says. So I think office workers also play a big role.
Do it to the best of your ability.
Yes.
And okay. We'll be discussing more on this topic because we have not really exhausted it. And so thank you all for your time, and thank you to our viewers for listening.